Good evening, a very good evening, all of you. I welcome all the subject experts and all the students from sixth semester in this orientation program for overview of optional subjects. And for this semester, we have Dr. Anjuvali Tikku, Dr. Sushmita Malaya, Dr. Shankar Singh Yadav, and Dr. Pushkar Anand for the purpose of giving you information about the importance and relevance and practical aspect of optional subjects. So to begin with, Dr. Sushmita Malaya. So I request Dr. Sushmita Malaya to enlighten us on the insurance and banking laws.
A warm good evening to all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, very much.
Yes. Hope all of you are doing good. At the outset, I congratulate the organizers for initiating such an orientation program to enlighten you which subject you want to choose. And always it happens because all the subjects are best, and out of the best, which one to choose is always a a dilemma. So this paper on banking, insurance and negotiable instrument, that is paper code is 60232. The importance of this paper, I hope that there is no need for much explanation, for the reason that you have witnessed during the COVID times how important was for the banks to deal with the economic crisis that the country is facing, not only in India, world over. So the banking is known as the kingpin of the chariot of economic progress. So economy is depending on the functions of the banking. So this paper is divided into three parts. First part deals with the banking, and in this banking part, this paper introduces the students with regard to the basic functions of the banking, the regulator, that is the Reserve Bank of India, who regulates. Then also it will give you insight with regard to the nationalization, because it's very important. We have seen that the banks were nationalized on one midnight, just like we have seen the notbandi. Similarly, on one fine morning, banks were nationalized, and now we are thinking of reverting back to non-nationalization. So of course this paper gives you the social control concept, nationalization concept, then the nature of the banker and the customer relationship. So that aspects of banking is covered in the part A of this topic. Then part two is again an important, because it deals with the insurance. We have seen during again this COVID times how important the policies were floated in the market, online policies, so much of things. So getting duped by these policies was also the important element. So we need to be careful. So this insurance part give you the insight with regard to the contractual principles governing the insurance, general principles of contract relating to the insurance. Then what is the ube rama fide principle. So this will give you the insight with regard to the insurance aspects and the cases, the very landmark cases. So basic understanding, okay, so basic understanding of the insurance as well as the banking is covered in part A and part B. And the whole paper is more highlighted with the Negotiable Instrument Act. So this is what this generally focusing. So these two are, part A and part B. The more focus of this paper is with the check bouncing cases, that is the Negotiable Instrument Act. What is a check and what are the other negotiable instruments? Then who are the parties, the liabilities of the parties relating to it? Then recently you might have seen that Delhi High Court, it has come up, and 34 courts have gone with, the e-paperless, 34 exclusive paperless courts has been introduced. So now e-filing of, the check bouncing cases is also happening. So that practical aspects, you will be getting insight if you read the provisions. So this paper are divided into three parts, part A, which deals with the banking, part B deals with the insurance, and part C deals with the Negotiable Instrument Act. So with this whole, these three parts, The object is to enlighten the students with regard to this very technical aspects of Insurance, Banking and Negotiable Instrument Act. And the outcome will be that if you go for the practice or any corporate areas, you will have, and even if you are not going any of this, for your personal benefit also, you will be at least aware what are all the avenues that you can explore. Okay, so if you have any of the doubts with regard to it further, you can ask me. Wish you all the best. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your views on the subject and explaining the subject so well. But and I hope that the students are really going to be benefited out of it, and it will help them to decide that which optional subject they are going to choose. So thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Anju, ma'am.
Okay, and now Dr. Anju Wali Tikku, ma'am, she was having some connectivity issue. She was facing some issues. I don't know whether she's the able to join back or not. Let me just check. I think she is not here. So in that situation, we'll continue with the another presenter, that is Dr. Shankar Singh Yadav. Dr. Shankar Singh Yadav will make a presentation on election laws. So I call upon Dr. Shankar Singh Yadav to make a presentation on the subject. Over to you, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to introduce the subject, election law. And today, I will give you the insights that what we teach in this particular subject, election law. And as you know, that the people are the ultimate sovereigns in a state where there is democratic system of governance. And the people chooses their representatives and rulers. The people of this great country, India, had a dream. Self-rule was the dream, as they did not want to be governed by the British. And India achieved its independence in 1947. Thereafter, we, the people of India, resolved to constitute India as a democratic republic. As you know, democracy is a form of government in which the people have the authority to choose their governing legislation, and the government or political system is governed by representatives who are elected by the people. It can also be called as the government of the people, government by the people, and government for the people. Republic means that the head of the state is not a monarch, but from among the citizens. So we can say that in a democratic state, the people are the ultimate sovereigns, and they are having the power to choose their representatives and their government. As we have a democratic system of governance in our country, the elections must be free and fair, which is also the basic structure of the constitution. And therefore, to ensure free and fair elections, there must be a free and fair autonomous body to conduct elections. There must be laws prescribing rights and obligations of the voters and the candidates, and there must be rules and regulation to conduct elections. Here in this curriculum of election laws, we study about the law relating to elections in India. As the Constitution of India provides under Article 324 of the Constitution of India, that the superintendence, direction and control of the preparation of electoral rolls for and the conduct of all elections to the parliament of every state and of election to the office of the president and vice president of India shall be vested in the election commission. So the election commission is having the authority to conduct elections. The words superintendence, direction and control of and conduct of elections are being used in broadest term, but the election commission cannot defy the law, nor can it act arbitrarily. with the constitutional provisions which are being provided in part 15 of the Constitution of India, we also deal with certain provisions of other acts which are being passed by the Parliament of India. These are the Representation of People's Act 1950, the Representation of People's Act 1951, the Delimitation Act, the Election Commission Conduct of Service of Election Commissioners, and Transaction of Business Act 1991, the relevant provisions of the Indian Penal Code. Thereafter, the Parliament Prevention of Disqualification Act 1959, the Presidential and Vice Presidential Election Act 1952, the Election Reservation and Allotment Symbol Order 1968, and then the Anti-Defection Law, which is being provided in Schedule 10 of the Constitution of India. As far as the topic-wise curriculum is concerned, we have topic number one, which is relating to the meaning of election and disputes relating to elections to the parliament and state legislature. So first of all, we will provide an introduction to the elections, democratic process of elections, and some insights into the Indian electoral system. Thereafter, how the elections are to be conducted. However, the students have read that in the Constitution of India, but some insights has to be provided in it. Thereafter, if any candidate has filed any nomination paper to contest an election and his nomination paper has been rejected by the returning officer, then what can happen? Whether he can challenge the rejection of the nomination paper by the returning officer before the High Court by filing a writ petition under 226 of the Constitution of India, or there is some other procedure. So as far as the Representation of People's Act is concerned, the candidate whose nomination paper has been rejected by the returning officer cannot go under 226 of the Constitution of India, but a separate election petition has to be filed. So uske bare mein hum yahan padhenge. Thereafter, what are the contents of election petitions? What are the material facts and particulars which can be included in an election petition? Then what can be the reliefs which can be claimed by the candidate through an election petition? Then the topic number two is concerned with composition of parliament and the election of president and vice president. So the composition of parliament, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, that is being read by the students in the subject Constitution of India, uske bare mein hum yahan dobara baat karenge. Then we will deal with the delimitation of constituencies. As you know that in 2026 there will the constituencies of parliament, Lok Sabha, they will be again delimited. So delimitation, what is delimitation, how it will work, and what is the process of delimitation, we will deal with that. Thereafter, the election to the office of the president and vice president of India, and for that we have the Act, the Presidential and Vice Presidential Elections Act 1952. In that we will go through the conditions, qualifications and essentials to file the nomination papers and to contest an election for the office of the President and Vice President of India. We are having some leading cases, Charan Lal Sahu versus Gyani Jail Singh. We will also discuss these. Then the next topic deals with the composition, powers and function of the Election Commission. As the sole responsibility to conduct election is with the Election Commission of India, as Article 324 of the Constitution states that the superintendence, direction, control and conduct of all election to the parliament and state legislatures and to the office of the president and vice president are being vested with the Election Commission. So we have to read the powers and functions of the Election Commission. Then there have been certain disputes, especially after the Election Commission Condition of Service of Election Commissioners and Transaction of Business Act 1991, where the number of election commissioners has been increased from 1 to 3. So that dispute is to be read in the case of T.N. Session versus Union of India, 1995 Supreme Court. thereafter the power of the election commission to register and deregister a political party. So there are provisions in the law by which we can see that the election commission is registering a political party, but there is no such provision where the election commission can deregister a political party. So we have this particular case, Indian National Congress versus Institution of Social Welfare, where the Supreme Court has analyzed that whether the election commission is having the power to deregister a political party in certain circumstances. Then we have topic number 4, qualification and disqualifications of the candidates. Qualifications as prescribed in the Constitution of India, that the person who is a candidate filing the nomination paper must be a citizen of India, must have faith and allegiance in the Constitution and sovereignty and integrity of India. It is with regard to age, 25 years or 30 years as the case may be. Then he must be an elector in any parliamentary constituency of India, and that member must be a member of a particular caste जिसके लिए वो पर्टिकुलर कंस्टिट्यूएंसी रिजर्व की गई है. दीज आर द क्वालिफिकेशन. एज फार एज डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन, वी हैव स्पेसिफिकली मेंशनड हियर सम डिस्क्वालिफिकेशंस, लाइक डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ आउट ऑफ प्रॉफिट. वी हैव क्लासिक केस ऑफ जया बच्चन, वेयर शी वाज अपॉइंटेड एज द उत्तर प्रदेश फिल्म डेवलपमेंट काउंसिल की चेयरमैन. देन वी हैव डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ गवर्नमेंट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स, that if any person is having subsisting government contracts with appropriate government, then the person will be disqualified to contest an election for the state or parliament as the case may be. Then we have disqualification on the basis of conviction, that any person is convicted for any offense and he has been punished for more than 2 years, then he is being disqualified for a certain period of time to contest an election. And for that we have classical case of former Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Jayalalitha, Mrs. Jayalalitha. Then Navjot Singh Sidhu. We have a PIL of Lily Thomas versus Union of India, and Public Interest Foundation versus Union of India. Topic number 5 deals with anti-defection law. It is also very interesting provision which is being inserted in the Constitution of India by 52nd Amendment of the Constitution in 1985. By which, if any person who has any member who has contested an election from the ticket of a political party and he changes his allegiance to another political party or person after being declared as returned candidate, then with that change of allegiance to any other political party or he accept his political party, then his membership shall be cancelled, and there will be elections on that constituency again. So anti-defection law is again very interesting, and it has been inserted in 1985 with 52nd Amendment, when the government and the parliament saw that there is a great practice by various members, and it was started in 1967 with the state of Haryana's legislative assembly, that a particular member changes his allegiance to 3 political parties in a single day. After that, the parliament thought and they enacted law with regard to anti-defection. We have some classical cases here, R.S. Nayak versus Union of India, Goa case. We have this G. Vishwanathan versus Tamil Nadu Legislative Assembly. We have Rajendra Singh Rana versus Swami Prasad More, UP case, Uttar Pradesh case. Then we have the latest case, B.S. Yediyurappa related, Shrimat Balasaheb Patil versus Honorable Speaker, Karnataka Legislative Assembly, 2019 Supreme Court. Then topic number 6 deals with nominations. The requirement of valid nominations of candidates for elections. What are the requirements? The procedure of filing nomination papers, the name of proposers, the name of seconders, the security deposits, and like that. And the consequence of improper rejection of nomination paper and improper acceptance of nomination paper. In that case, the election will be declared as null and void. And in that case, there will be election in that constituency after declaring that election as null and void. This topic number 7 deals with the distinction between corrupt deals with corrupt practices, and there is a distinction between the corrupt practices which have been mentioned in the Representative One, Section 123 of that Act, and some offences, election offences, which are being mentioned in the Indian Penal Code. So first of all, there is distinction between the two. Then what are the corrupt practices under Section 123 of the Representation of Peoples Act 1923? These are the bribery, undue influence, appeal on the ground of religion, race, caste, community, language, and promotion of feeling of enmity or hatred between different classes of citizens of India on the ground of religion, race, caste, community, and language. Then we have publication of false statements of facts in relation to personal character or conduct of any candidate. Then we have free conveyance of voters, incurring or authorizing expenditure in excess of permissible limit, and booth capturing. And then last corrupt practice we have is obtaining or procuring the assistance of government servants, with a classical case of Indira Gandhi versus Raj Narayan 1975, where there was allegation that she used government machinery in her parliamentary elections. The last topic of this particular subject, election law, is the voters have to know the antecedents of the candidates. We will go through that what the Supreme Court has suggested with regard to the rights of voters to know the antecedents of the candidates. We are here with certain amendments of the or certain provisions of the Representation of Peoples Act, like Section 33A, 33B, and 125A, which specifically says that any person who is filing the nomination paper as a candidate of any election that has to mention certain things. One is the criminal antecedents, that if there is a criminal prosecution against him. Second is regarding his family members, and the third is regarding his wealth. So every voter is having the right to know about the candidate who is contesting an election and who is going to be the representative of the people. So these are the 8 topics which are being discussed in this election law paper. And I hope that the students will generate their interest in understanding this particular subject, in knowing this particular subject relating to election, because it is a subject which is very relevant. As we are living in a democratic state, and free and fair election is again and again held by Supreme Court as the basic structure of the Constitution, and every voter must have certain knowledge regarding the elections, and he is having the right to know about the candidates who are contesting the election. So I hope that this will generate their interest in the electoral process. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving insight about the subject and sharing all the relevant information regarding election procedure and the powers of election commissioner and the functions. So thank you so much, sir. I hope that the students will definitely be benefited out of it. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now, Anju ma'am, time back. So ma'am, I invite you for your presentation. I think connectivity issues have been solved. So ma'am, please.
थैंक यू अंजू आपका और मेरा नाम एक ही है
yes, ma'am.
लेकिन अंदाज शायद कुछ फर्क होगा it was not a connectivity issue, rather it is some technical glitch, so that I have to revert back to my phone, which I initially started off with, and then I thought maybe because I'm not at my home. So anyway, coming to the topic straight away, first of all, let me welcome the students entering into third year. Aap sabhi ka swagat hai. Aur ummeed hai ki aakhri saal hamein bahut kuch naya dekhne ko milega, seekhne ko milega, and hopefully we would be away from this entire difficult testing, trying time, so that by the end of the third year, we would have learned not only theoretically, but psychologically, socially, emotionally, legally, lot many things. And with that positive thinking approach towards life, talking to you about this interpretation of statutes, let me confess that this happens to be the first, this would be rather the second time that I would be teaching the subject. But what I realize after having taught the subject for one semester is that this is the subject that each one of us must learn, must know. Because whenever we are talking about law, irrespective of the fact whether we are going to continue our journey in relation with law, be that as a lawyer, be that as a judge, or going across as legal officers, or we are, say, draft persons, we are associated with think tanks, we are dealing with the language of law. So irrespective of which specific direction we choose, my understanding is that one should be able to understand the language of law, the context of law, rules, regulations, etc., etc. And we are all aware by now, being into the third year, that there's that general statement which invariably props up here and there, and which says that life of law is logic. But I'm afraid it's not always logic. We interpret law, we apply law in lot many situations, not on the basis of logic. Perhaps somewhere as common sense, perhaps somewhere as what would be convenient. So logic and convenience gets interlinked. Now, what I want you people to understand is that interpretation of statutes would be talking about not only the interpretation, the understanding, the meaning, the construction of a statute, but also the meaning, understanding, interpretation, construction of the Constitution as well. I believe we all agree and appreciate that all our laws derive their legitimacy and sanctity from the Constitution of India, which happens to be, in Kelsenian sense, the grand norm. तो अगर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन से हमें सब जो भी कोई चीज जो भी लॉ हम बात करते हैं उसकी एप्लीकेबिलिटी उसकी ऑथेंटिसिटी उसकी लीगैलिटी और लेजिटिमेसी के लिए अगर हम कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन की ओर देखते हैं तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का इंटरप्रिटेशन कैसे होगा एंड वी ऑल अंडरस्टैंड एंड नो एंड दोज ऑफ यू हु हैव बीन एसोसिएटेड विद मी एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम ड्यूरिंग द प्रीवियस टू ईयर्स We have highlighted that whenever we are talking about constitution, the preamble is good enough. So that even if we do not have rest of the provisions of the constitution, which happens to be incidentally the longest constitution of the world, if we had only the preamble, our job would have been similarly, effectively, efficiently taken care of. Because the preamble is a sacrosanct, may I say, para, which gives you that discretion, that space, that flexibility, and the expediency to deal with each and every situation. So interpretation of statutes is a paper which is a must, though it is an optional paper. But I would advise and suggest to people that even if you prefer to opt for any other paper which may be relevant to you or your priority at this point of time, keeping in mind your immediate near future or for that matter your career prospects, etc., etc. So if you want to go in for say some commercial papers, etc., what I would suggest is that you need to acquaint yourself with the technicalities which are dealt with in this paper, and they are basically certain theories and certain rules of interpretation which are really handy in understanding the language which is used in our laws. Though you will find legislative drafting is another paper, but the fact of the matter remains that there are lot many institutions where interpretation of statutes and legislative drafting is taught together as components of one subject, one paper. Because when we are talking about legislative drafting, what all goes in the drafting of a law, and once it has been drafted, how we are going to interpret it is also relevant, and the two of them do overlap with each other. So cutting the whole story short, I'll just make one sentence, one statement, and that statement is, हमने कई जगह सुना होगा, पढ़ा होगा कि कुछ लिखा हुआ है और शरारती तत्वों ने, बच्चों ने, बड़ों ने, मस्खरों ने उसमें से या तो कॉमा हटा दिया, ये एक अल्फाज हटा दिया, एक अल्फाबेट हटा दिया, तो पूरा का पूरा मतलब बदल जाता है चीज का। तो अभी मेरे दिमाग में फिलहाल जो आ रहा है, एक मैं चार शब्दों को आपके सामने बोल रही हूँ हिंदी के, रोको मत जाने दो। अब शब्द तो चार ही हैं, लेकिन आप इसको कैसे समझते हैं, कैसे बयान करते हैं, कैसे लिखते हैं, उससे सारा मायना बदल जाता है। अब अगर मैं कहती हूँ रोको मत जाने दो, सो आई एम पुटिंग अ कॉमा आफ्टर रोको एंड देन देर आर द थ्री वर्ड्स मत जाने दो, विच मीन्स दैट प्लीज इट इज समवेयर, इट इज ईदर प्लीज और इट इज विद इन विद अ फर्म ऑर्डर दैट स्टॉप, डोंट लेट द अदर पर्सन गो, डोंट लेट हिम और हर गो। And if instead I break it up in two parts and I say, roko mat, jane do. So again the four words, but with the comma in the middle, two words here and two words there, changes the whole perspective, changes the whole meaning. So that what now I am saying is commanding or suggesting or requiring is that don't stop. Let the person go. So if the use of this comma has brought about such a 180 degree difference in the perspective, in the understanding, the meaning, and it's not about my dears the perspective, it's the meaning has changed. Similarly, the interpretation of statutes through different rules is letting us understand the nuances, that how we are going to read the language of a particular law. तो हम किस कानून का क्या मतलब निकालेंगे, कैसे निकालेंगे, इसके लिए हमने कुछ, basically if you look into the website of law faculty, you will find there is this paper interpretation of statutes, and I would advise you people to please have a look on the website and figure out this paper and try to just look into the content page, because I'm sure it is not possible and you would not be interested to go into the details, but just have a cursory look to the content page and you will find we are primarily having four topics. Out of those four topics, the very first one is talking about the constitutional interpretation or the general theories is the second paper, general theories with the rules of interpretation, and underneath that you will find there are couple of rules, something like literal rule, mischief rule, golden rule, strict interpretation, purposive interpretation, and then we also have something like egestem generis. I believe you must have heard that phrase, egestem generis, wherein we say that a particular phrase, a specific terminology which is followed after a few words, the meaning of those few words would be attested, would be assigned, keeping in mind the phrase that is being used. And then we have the third topic which talks about the intrinsic or internal aid, and the fourth one is the extrinsic or external aid. Let me just give you a brief in one or two sentences an understanding that when we are talking about interpretation of statutes, we are primarily going to understand that here is the language of law, here is a law. Say for example, I'm talking about Indian Penal Code. Please excuse me because I have an affinity with penal code and law of crimes. because I have been teaching all these years, for decades together, criminal law for that matter. If you are keen in your corporate law or for that matter competition law, you'll find that there are these statutes which have preamble. There is the reasons and objects. There is also mentioned, at times you will find that there is the marginal note. So those of you who might have read MRTP as a precursor to competition law, you will find that there was the marginal note. Or if you happen to look into a pickup or law commission reports, you will find that there are marginal notes. Now, each and every component of any particular legislation, statute or act has got its significance. Punctuations have got their own significance. When you're talking about an, is, the, they have got their own significance. And if I might give you one example, we have Article 21. Interestingly, even if you are not going to choose interpretation of statutes, but I would certainly cajole and impress upon you people to please think over that how is it and why is it that the Supreme Court judges are able to give meaning to Article 21, right to life, in so many instances, in such a varied manner, and you will find that they are able to wriggle their way up within the language of Article 21, life, and the meaning, the scope, the content which has been given to this word life, so that you pick up anything pertaining to existential needs of life, with reference to that you will find there is a judgment which says that yes, this is part and parcel of life. But please take care. Article 21 doesn't talk about education, doesn't talk about explicitly, doesn't talk about pollution-free environment, doesn't talk about water, doesn't talk about right to livelihood, right to food. But they have been all brought within this terminology of life. How was it? It is only through construction of this word life. How do you see it? How do you argue it? How do you convince the other person that life is meaningless without this? So that precisely is the role of understanding the hows and whys of reading law. So it's not only a statute, but how best you can understand the intent of the writer, the author of a given piece. And please bear in mind that for people belonging to law, words, vocabulary, and the language is of utmost importance, relevance, and significance. So that until and unless we are able to catch hold of, grab, and have mastery on the words, vocabulary, the language, the intent, not only the spoken, but the written also. And how do we interpret, how do we understand? So there are small minuties which we need to grasp. And it is from that standpoint that interpretation of statutes is very, very important. I would say it is the crux of law. So that if you look into the content page, you will find that there are a lot many cases mentioned in the course material which is being uploaded there. But within that, you will find there are several cases from criminal law, several cases from constitutional law, or for that matter under 19(1)(g), so that you will understand that interpretation of statute is unlike any other specific singular law. So, for example, if you're talking about corporate law, then you have got the Partnership Act, you have got the Companies Act. But with reference to interpretation of statutes, please bear in mind there is no single law. There is no statute. Rather, we are talking about the interpretation and understanding of various statutes across different streams, across different fields, so that until and unless we learn the art of reading the law, which would be certainly helpful and beneficial through interpretation of statutes, until and unless we learn that, even if we opt for XYZ paper, we will not be able to really understand the meaning. And lo and behold, in 3 years, we do not read all the laws, all the statutes. We have to come across, stumble over different pieces of legislations over a period of time. And once we have grasped the understanding of learning how to read and understand a law, any law, howsoever difficult and complicated, it would be easier for us to understand, learn, implement, execute, and then to come out of the difficulties that might have been put across our way. And that's how we would be able to handle and tackle every stumbling block. So with that basic understanding of what is this interpretation of statutes, not any single law or legislation, but cutting across different streams pertains to each and every law. And that's where what I would highlight is, it is basically understanding the significance of constitutional text, and that is being associated along with General Clauses Act, so that anywhere in any law, if a term has not been defined, then we fall back on General Clauses Act. So General Clauses Act along with the Constitution gives us the whole horizon across which we can understand, construct, and move forwards to deal with each and every regulatory regime. With that, I'll stop unless you have got some queries. I'll be open to address that. Thank you very much, Andrew, for giving me that opportunity. And all the best to all the students aspiring into the third year, and best wishes for the golden future and happy times ahead, meeting physically and interacting. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the excellent information. And in a very well, you have explained the importance of the subject, the relevance of the subject very nicely and in a very interesting manner. So it was a pleasure to hear you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
So now I'll call upon Dr. Pushkar Anand, who is the last presenter, and he'll speak on the Minor Act. So I hope Dr. Pushkar is there. Dr. Pushkar?
Yes, ma'am, he is there.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, good evening.
Yes, over to you, Dr. Pushkar. Pushkar, you are not audible. Pushkar, you are not audible. I think there is some technical glitch or connectivity issues. I think Pushkar is having some connectivity issues. In the meantime, I would like to take up one query. Pushkar, you have joined?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible now?
Yes, you are audible. Yes, please start with your presentation.
Right. Thank you so much. I'm really sorry for intermittent connection. That's why.
No issues, Pushkar. Okay.
Okay, so good evening, everyone. So today I'm here to discuss. I'll not take much of your time. Today we are going to, I'll simply tell you about this particular subject, that is Minor Acts and Supreme Court Rules. Now, of course, this is an optional paper, and to talk about this subject is primarily a part of the procedural law that you would have studied by now. I mean, you would be in your final semester, and by this time you would have already studied laws such as Transfer of Property Act, and for that matter, Civil Procedure Code. And you would have also studied by now Constitution. So the point is, this particular act consists of, the syllabus of this particular act consists of three main acts. One is the Indian Registration Act. Now, when you would have studied the Transfer of Property Act, jab aap logon ne padha hoga, तो उसमें आपने इंडियन रजिस्ट्रेशन एक्ट का मेंशन पाया होगा, तो एक तरीके से द ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट प्लस द इंडियन रजिस्ट्रेशन एक्ट बेसिकली दे कंप्लीट अ कोड. सो इन अ वे आपको ये समझना है कि ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट को कंप्लीट करता है इंडियन रजिस्ट्रेशन एक्ट. सो वट एवर कन्वेंसिंग वट एवर ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी टेक्स प्लेस देर आर सर्टन काइंड ऑफ ट्रांसफर दैट नीड टू बी रजिस्टर्ड राइट. सो इंडियन रजिस्ट्रेशन एक्ट टॉक्स अबाउट दैट एंड प्राइमरली इट टॉक्स अबाउट the consequence of non-registration and the consequences of registration. Now, for instance, if a particular instrument, such as sale deed or for that matter, mortgage deed, if it is registered, then it has a certain evidentiary value. And if the same is not registered, then it cannot be accepted as an evidence in law. So these are the aspects that you would study in the Indian Registration Act. Then what you have is a Stamp Duty Act. Now, if you look at Indian Stamp Duty Act, that is another legislation that you have to study here. Indian Stamp Duty Act is a kind of, let's say, revenue generating. I mean, it's a legislation. It's a kind of revenue legislation. So it is a kind of tax that is levied on any conveyancing that happens. So, for instance, if there is a insufficient stamp duty which has been paid on any particular transfer, then that particular document, again, it will not be accepted in evidence. It will not be a valid document. So similarly, Indian Stamp Duty Act has to be studied. And these acts are very small acts. I mean, the provisions are not very comprehensive provisions. Stamp duty needs to be calculated. So in the legislation, you would find a particular table which details that what is the stamp duty which is to be collected on a particular instrument. For instance, if it is a mortgage document, it will be documented. It will be listed there that what is the stamp duty that has to be paid? What is the value that how much stamp duty has to be collected on how much value? So all these things are mentioned in that particular act only. And even in the examination, for instance, if you are given a question related to the calculation of stamp duty, then you would be provided the bare acts. So from that perspective, yes, Indian Stamp Duty Act is an important legislation because this act provides for revenue generation for the government on the transfer of property or on the conveyancing deed, which are signed. So these are the two acts. Then what you have is the Court Fees Act. Now the Court Fees Act again, so it is once again a part of procedural law. So whenever any suit is filed in any court, so a certain amount is to be paid as the court fees. Now there's a reason behind levying court fees, that why court fees is taken. Uska reason simple sa ye hai, because court is an institution, aur kisi bhi institution ko chalane ke liye there has to be a certain amount of revenue which is to be generated. To ye revenue generate karne ke liye kya kisi bhi suit par court fees lagai jati hai. और कोर्ट फीस कितनी होगी, दैट विल डिपेंड ऑन द वैल्यू ऑफ द सूट राइट. सो अगेन सेम एज स्टैम्प ड्यूटी एक्ट, जिस तरीके से स्टैम्प ड्यूटी एक्ट में एक टेबल बना होता है, आपको पूरा शेड्यूल मिलेगा जिसमें डिपेंडिंग ऑन द नेचर ऑफ द कन्वेंसिंग डीड स्टैम्प ड्यूटी फिक्स होती है. उसी तरीके से कोर्ट फीस एक्ट में भी, कोर्ट फीस एक्ट जब आप देखेंगे तो किस तरीके के सूट पर कितने वैल्यू के सूट पर कितनी कोर्ट फीस लेनी है, दैट इज प्रोवाइडेड. Then what you have is the Suits Valuation Act. Now it is the smallest of the four legislations that you have to study. Suit Valuation Act again is a part of procedural law because the Suit Valuation Act basically is used to value the suits. जो किसी भी सिविल कोर्ट का जो jurisdiction होता है, जो आप लोगों ने CPC में पढ़ा होगा section 9 के अंदर, तो suits का valuation तय करने के लिए there is a proper rule and those rules are mentioned in the Suit Valuation Act कि jurisdiction किसी भी कोर्ट का बनेगा या नहीं बनेगा. वो तय करने के लिए आपको ये जानना होगा कि उस सूट की वैल्यू कितनी है, बिकॉज पिक्यूनरी ज्यूरिसडिक्शन जो होता है वो जो अमाउंट ऑफ सूट है उसके ऊपर तय किया जाता है. सो सीन फ्रॉम दैट पर्सपेक्टिव, सूट वैल्यूएशन एक्ट अगेन इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट प्रोसीजरल लॉ विच इन अ वे कॉम्प्लीमेंट्स एंड कंप्लीट्स द सिविल प्रोसीजर कोड. एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम दीज फोर लेजिस्लेशन, दैट इज इंडियन रजिस्ट्रेशन एक्ट, कोर्ट फीस एक्ट, स्टैम्प ड्यूटी एक्ट एंड सूट वैल्यूएशन एक्ट, व्हाट यू हैव टू स्टडी इज the Supreme Court rules. Now under Article 145 of the Constitution, jo aapke Supreme Court rule, Supreme Court has got this power to frame rules for running its administration. So Article 145 ke andar Supreme Court ne jo rules frame kiye hain, un rules ko study karna hai ki kis tarike se Supreme Court mein koi bhi petition padegi, wo chahe habeas corpus writ petition ho ya fir normal jo aapka original jurisdiction of Supreme Court ho, आर्टिकल 131 या फिर आपका स्पेशली पिटिशन हो, तो किसका क्या फॉर्मेट होगा, किसमें क्या कंटेंट होना चाहिए, what are the specific rules which have to be followed, all those things are mentioned in the Supreme Court rules. So these are the things that you have to study. Now, why choose this particular subject? So the students which have specifically made their mind as to they want to go in litigation only, right? So for those students, I think this is a must have subject, must opt subject. उनको ये बिल्कुल ये सारे subjects लें, ये सब्जेक्ट लेना चाहिए, क्योंकि लिटिगेशन में आप जाएंगे तो एनीवे आपको कोर्ट फीस, स्टैम्प ड्यूटी, रजिस्ट्रेशन और सुप्रीम कोर्ट रूल्स का आइडिया होना चाहिए. तो उस हिसाब से ये एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट सब्जेक्ट है. और जो टारगेट ऑडियंस है इस पर्टिकुलर सब्जेक्ट का, वो भी हमने बता दिया कि जो स्पेसिफिकली लिटिगेशन के लिए जा रहे हैं उनके लिए तो ये मस्ट है ही. एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट देयर आर सर्टेन जुडिशियल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन ऑल्सो वेयर इन दीज सब्जेक्ट्स आर पार्ट ऑफ द सिलेबस. तो उनके लिए भी है कि जहां पर अगर ऐसे एस्पिरेंट्स हैं तो वो भी ये सब्जेक्ट चूज कर सकते हैं, बिकॉज इट वुड ओनली हेल्प देम इन द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ देयर इट विल हेल्प देम इन देयर प्रिपरेशन. या सो दैट इज इट अबाउट द सब्जेक्ट. सो आई मीन आई विल कम अगेन इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस. थैंक यू.
Yes, thank you, Pushkar, for your enlightening words, and I am sure that it's going to help the students in choosing, in taking a decision to choose the optional subjects. So thank you so very much. Now, before handing over the mic to Shivika for vote of thanks, I would like to answer one query. The query regarding law of carriage. Law of carriage, which is being offered in the option form, but which because the requisite number of students, they don't opt this subject. So we don't open this subject for the last few years. So this was the query which was asked perhaps by Arvind. So Arvind, I think you have got the answer of your query, and it was informed in the introductory speech also that this subject we don't open because the requisite number of students, they don't opt for this particular subject. So that is the reason that a law of carriage you don't find in their Google option form. So with this, I hand over the mic to Shivika for vote of thanks. Over to you, Shivika.
A very good evening to distinguished panelists, our most valued, enthusiastic students, and my worthy colleagues. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of Timetable and Subject Allocation Committee of Law Center 1 and the entire organizing team, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all of you for making time from your commitments to grace this function. We place on record our utmost gratitude to our professor in charge, Professor Dr. Sarbjeet Kaur, for this wonderful endeavor to reach out to students. Ma'am's dedication to imparting impactful legal education and her guidance and immaculate planning is truly appreciable. Thank you, ma'am. I also express my sincere gratitude to the resource persons for graciously accepting our invitation. Most warm gratitude to our very own Professor Ved Kumari. Ma'am, the students would have greatly benefited from your erudite elaboration of the scope and relevance in contemporary times of the subject gender justice and feminist jurisprudence, engendering of law, society, and the gaps such as inheritance and misplaced understanding of gender would be important takeaways for the students. Thank you, ma'am. Extend a gratitude to Dr. Suman. Students have been enriched from your rich experience of humanitarian refugee law, which you elaborated through contemporary examples. And a series of expressions of gratitude is sincerely due to Dr. Gurpreet Singh for acquainting the students with international institutions, Dr. Surendra Mehra for familiarizing students with competition law, Dr. Preeti Rana for throwing light on legislative drafting, Dr. Amrinder Kumar Ajit for sharing your thoughts on intellectual property rights law. And after that, I place my place on record gratitude to resource persons of subject options of the sixth semester. A hearty thank you to Dr. Anjuvali Tiku. Ma'am, your exposition of the interpretation of statutes and the principle of legislation would greatly benefit the students, especially how punctuation may change perspectives with the example of Ruko Mat Jane Do and understanding the hows and the whys of reading law. Dr. Sushmita P. Malia for introducing students to insurance and banking law, Dr. Shankar Singh Yadav for familiarizing with election laws, Mr. Pushkar Anand for providing scope and significance of minor act and Supreme Court rules, especially for those opting for litigation. Dear resource persons, your wonderful ideas, sharing of experience and future ramifications of the optional subjects would greatly benefit the students. And we have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of dedicated colleagues, Mr. Anil Sen, the convener, Ms. Sachi Singh, the co-convener, and members Dr. Anju Sinha and Dr. Sanjeevi Raina. We are thankful for this support. And most importantly, the students of Law Center 1 are the backbone of this event. In case you intend to make changes to the subject options filled in the admission form, then please note, you may kindly fill the form notified on the website for the 4 and 6 terms. Also note that the last date to fill the form for making changes to optional subjects which have been chosen by you in admission form is Thursday, that is December 17th of this week. And for your record, whenever you're submitting a form, which has been, the link has been shared, a copy of the form is mailed automatically to the email that you've utilized to fill the form. So you will get a receipt of the form. Also, please note the recording of this orientation program is available on Law Center 1 website and also the Law Center 1 YouTube channel. Wishing you all a very all the very best in all your future endeavors. And I'm certain that this orientation program would have given you more clarity and certainty in choosing your optional subjects as well. Stay safe, stay blessed. Thank you all.